Hello out there, programmers and future programmers, or past programmers. This is my third lesson, and I thought with this lesson I'd cap off the last two lessons. In case you haven't seen them, show you what I've created. First, I created this D64 file to save all my work in, and the projects that I first put in here, the first project I did and wanted you to do was the character to ASCII program that was in my very first lesson. And then I put these other files, which are files I created years ago, because they're going to aid me in teaching you graphics and sprites. I have a sprite designer program. That's in one of my videos, another video that I did before I started my lessons. And I have several sets of sprites, which I'm going to show you how to load them into a program, create them with Sprite Designer, and then these files here were created with my Sprite Designer program. These four files that have sprites in them. And I'm going to show you how you can use them in your own programs later on when I get into the programming sprites. So in lesson two, I created a clock. Which is the first program that I have written in 8 years. And if you load a COMMA8 program, you have to either clear what else is on that line or put a colon after it, because a colon is the end of a statement and the computer will not try to read anything past that before it executes the command. So this is a command to load, and I typed in the wrong. See, I've got two D64 image files loaded up on this, one in drive 8, one in drive 9. This should have been drive 9. And this is the amount of code I needed to do what I needed to do. To extract, to use the TI function, or the TI variable, system variable. If I type it to print out, TI. And the reason I normally don't separate them is because you use less space. And I want you to get used to compacting everything in Commodore. It's something you can do with Commodore that you can't do with any other basic emulator that I know of. And from the time that you turn your computer on or run Vice, it starts counting, and it counts not just seconds. As a matter of fact, the third number over are the seconds. Then you go in tenths of seconds and hundredths of seconds. But you don't have to take that into consideration when doing all these calculations, because it automatically returns in seconds. So go back and watch that first video if you want, or the second video if you want to know more about how I did this. Now I'm going to work on this. I'm going to improve this because I'm going to make a graphic display. But I needed this code first, and then I'm going to connect the actual numbers with my graphics display. So let me load that one. I just started working on it yesterday or the day before. which I'm calling Big Clack. But I want to show you what I've done so far on it. Keep you up to date on it. I'm not going to take much time on this because I want to get into showing you something else. You see, I've got more to my program, but all I've done is put these data statements in here. And these data statements use a cursor movements and special graphics to move the cursor around and actually draw the digit on the screen. And when I get it done, I need to use the read data statement to load up the graphics into an array, which I'll be getting into teaching you about arrays later on. But let me just give you a demonstration how that works in real time outside of the program. And I'm going to do that by putting in a for next loop. There are 10 data lines in there, so I have to read the data 10 times. So I'm going to create a for next loop to do that. I'm going to create for, let's just say I equals 1 to 10. Then I'm going to tell it to read. I'm just going to say read $1. I'm going to use it over and over just to print out on the screen. But this will, each time you read it, it'll erase the one before it. So I need to print it again right afterwards. That's why it needs to be loaded into an array so that you don't have, so that you have a separate variable for each card that you can, or for each display. Anyway, next I'm going to tell it to print $1, and then next. Then you don't have to say next I. The computer automatically knows it's going to be next I. You can say next I to specify it, but and there are my numbers. I'm still going to tweak them, but eventually I hope to display these instead of the actual numbers. So that's where I'm at with this right now. And I'll keep you up to date on it. But if you want to, I just take a line out in this that was unnecessary. If you copied my other one, there's a line that you don't need. Of course, you can't see it in this one now, but if you copy this code right up to the data, and forget about the REM statement, that was for my own use while I was creating my data statements. And I'll explain how to get the graphics to create your display when I'm done with this. So now let's go right to my card construction, which is available at my website. And that's in device 8. We're on drive 8. And I created this years ago because I wanted to create tools for other programmers, people learning to program, to make it easy and show how to structure a program and how to create things like cards using the same method that I'm creating my digits for my clock. And I went about this in a similar way by first creating a shuffle I call Jiffy Shuffle, because I compacted it into a very short program to make it as fast as I possibly could. And it shuffles 52 cards in less than two seconds. This is the raw code. So you can copy this down too if you're going to get into making cards, or you'll be able to download it off my site. Now, display it. This is all there is to the shuffle. And this shuffle will be a subroutine when you use all 52 cards in the game, when you're playing a game, then you can go out to the subroutine and shuffle them again so they won't be in the same order. And this is the interesting thing about Commodore, is it has a real random number generator that gives you actual random numbers. If you try this on a regular basic emulator, like GW, I believe it's called, because I did write this on another one, and it appeared to give you random numbers, but if you ran the stopped the program, ran it again, it ran the same numbers. It started off and ran the same numbers, so they weren't actual real random numbers. Commodore gives you actual real random numbers, which is cool about it. And see, if I run it again, now if this was on any other one, you'd get the exact same random numbers, which aren't real random numbers. But if I run this again on Commodore, it doesn't give you the same numbers. So if you want this random number generator for 52 cards, and you can change this to more than 52, you know, you can use this in lotto numbers, you know, creating randomly generated lotto numbers. But this is the code for that. Okay. Now all these little characters you see, that's just for visual, you know, on the screen, how to make them display, make things display the way I want them to display. You don't have to worry about this. This is actually a down cursor movement. So this was the first thing I wrote before I ever designed my cards. Now, let me show you how I progressed on this, because these are all progressions. This is all evolution of my card construction set. And I have a shuffle demo. This might be the same thing, I'm not sure. Jiffy Shuffle, shuffle demo, where I actually shuffle the cards. No, it can't be, because that's only two blocks. So let me load up the 64 card deck. And I'm sure I have the shuffle in here, so. Okay, now. Okay. Let's see what the cell that starts off here. Okay, let's okay, see, all this is where my card data is. You look familiar? All data statements, and then the data is loaded into an array. And first you go sub, load up the card data. Oh, this isn't even loading the card data, it's just printing it out. I think this is all this does is just print it out. Hang on. Let's go back to that section there. See, I mean, it's been 30 years since I even looked at this information. Oh, I didn't hit the right key to stop it. Didn't hit the escape key. You see, I go from 1 to 13 because I load, like, spades first. And, like, spades, clubs, hearts, and diamonds. So, in their own little section. Okay, let me run this, see exactly how it runs. loading up the data. And there's the cards now displaying. That's all this really does, is loads them up and then displays them. And these are all standard graphics. I did create a card using specially designed graphics, which I designed all the graphics for my other deck of cards. But this takes up less memory using this deck. Probably overall, well, maybe not necessarily faster once everything's loaded up. So that was basically the second thing that I did. Then I actually started, once I got that done, got my cards, I actually started creating games, and then I created my other graphics and created a game with that. So some of these games I created are partial games, that's what they are. They're all on BASIC. So you can actually take these programs and extend on them and make them work better. Like my poker demo, all it does is deal out a poker hand, has you take, you know, ask you how many cards you want for your hand, and then gives you a hand. You're not actually playing a game of poker. So you could take this poker game demo and actually make an actual poker game out of it. So let me load in the poker demo first. Let's list the program here. There's my data. You see, there's not much coding into it because it didn't take that much coding to, most of the coding is the cards. And this might actually be, because it's this long, it might actually be the card deck that I made this special graphics for. But you see, if you want to program cards and you download my pack, my card construction pack. No, these are just, yeah, okay, let's see. I'm going to try for another pair. Say I want three cards. Number one, three, and four. Yeah, so this is my special deck. So, now, since I changed, and how I got the special deck, without using any sprites at all, this is how it's done. All your key graphics and your letters and everything are all stored in a location in memory that is called ROM memory, which means you cannot do anything to change them. But you can copy all the characters from ROM into a section of RAM, and then you can set up the pointer, which all your different pointers are in the beginning part of your memory and on the Commodore. All you have to do is change that pointer to tell it to get the keystrokes and graphics from a different location. And once you do that, if you don't change it back, then I may have changed it back. No, I couldn't have. You should still see them in there. Probably in the data section. Because I didn't change any of the numbers of the letters. And here you go. You see how those graphics look different? At least some of them. But I've already done this for you if you wanted to use these cards. Let me do a soft reset here. Okay, card trick. And I have a card trick on here. That's in one of my other videos. And the Casino Commodore is in one of my other videos. So, what I've done now is here is the card data, which if you were going to design your own cards, you'd load this up first. So you see, this card data starts at 61900. And when you, so you have plenty of room to write a program. And the program, you'd tell it, I have all the instructions in here. Let me load the instructions up and go through those. So this is all programming that you won't even need to do at all. All you need to do is load this up. Actually, it loads it up. It already loads it up into an array, and all you have to do is use that array in your programs. I got this all on my site for download, and set of instructions, 45 blocks worth of instructions. So and I put this at the beginning so you can actually auto run the instructions from your device emulator. And okay. And then you just stop the program if you wanna, or stop this video if you wanna, from going too fast for you. But it tells you exactly how to use my cards in your own program. Oh, you know what? I think it's just an. I put the wrong. And I didn't take that in consideration. You see how the graphics has changed, though. Let's try this again. Put actual numbers I'm supposed to. Oh. Yeah, I forgot it does that, see? You know, because the graphics were changed. That's why it looks weird now. These are the graphic, special graphics cards that I created. Try that again. Now, if you type zero, that should be the back card. See, that's the back card. You can make that any color you want, by the way. Try 52. 52 is an ace. So you can keep track of them easy because they're in an order. So that is my card construction set. This isn't an actual lesson, this third one, more to catch you up to speed on what I'm doing and where I'm going with my lessons. So if you want to continue, you want to learn more, then keep following me. I'll explain things more and more as I go. It takes time because it took me a long time to learn how to do all this stuff myself. So keep on following me and give yourself something to do while you're hunkered down and avoiding the virus that we're all self-quarantining ourselves for, which I hope we are doing the best we can. So take it from there and look for my next lesson. Thank you very much.